Hello children, children of standard 9th, I have explained first lesson then the grass is really like me, this poem I have explained, and second lesson Mauritius by R.K. Lakshman. And now I am going to deal with that is poem, second poem, that is Africa. Africa, now warm up activity. Look at the following personalities. Two pictures are given here in your textbook. What do you think they are known for? How they are known? How they have become well known? Discuss with your friends in groups their contribution to the world and humanity. What was their contribution to this world? And what were their principles on humanity? You have also to identify these two pictures. Whose pictures are these? Now about the poem. The poem is a reminiscence about Africa. It tells about Africa, how the black people were troubled, tortured, a land about which the poet heard from his grandmother's song. He had never been to Africa before, only he had heard from his grandmother the history of Africa. The story of Africa was heard by his grandmother. Well, I would like to tell you all, in olden days the grandmothers used to grind on the grinding stone and used to sing the history of the country, ballads on the warriors, and thus this was the method of giving the idea of the country or village or a town or a province or of the warriors. Here also the poet's grandmother used to sing about African people. Africa means African people. He paints the vivid picture of the history of African colonialism and the strength of African people. He used the picture, vivid picture, of the African colonialism and the strength of African people, how they endured, how they sustained the tortures and troubles given by the white people. Now, in the history of Africa, we can find Nelson Mandela, Martin Luther King. They fought against giving independence to the African people. Slaves, these slaves were even sold in the markets. Slavery was there. So here the poem starts. Africa, my Africa, he says. This Africa is my Africa, Africa of proud warriors. warriors and ancestral Shravanas. This Africa of the ancestral people, Africa from whom my grandmother sings, he has heard about this history from his grandmother on the banks of the distant river. This Africa is located on the banks of the distant river, that is Saradas. I have never known you. Actually, the poet doesn't know anything about Africa. He has only heard from his grandmother. I have never known you, but your blood flows in my veins. Poet says, though I do not know you, but the African blood flows in my veins. Poet says, the African blood flows in his veins. Your beautiful black blood that irrigates the fields. They are black people. They are tortured. So he says, black blood. This is alliteration. Beautiful black blood. Underline this beautiful black word. I will write on the board. I have taught you all about alliteration. Beautiful black blood. B. All three consonants are there. So it is alliteration. This is alliteration. B. Beautiful black blood. When you were in 8th standard, I had taught you all what alliteration is. I had given some other poems, examples with alliteration. Here, if only beautiful black blood is given, then it is alliteration. And if this complete line is given, your beautiful black blood, this is alliteration figure of speech. Your beautiful black blood. That irrigates. The fields. If this is there, then it is personification. Personification figure of speech. We can find two figures of speech here. The first is alliteration, if only beautiful black blood is given. And if the complete line is given, beautiful black blood that irrigates the field. Then it is personification figure of speech. Means the slaves actually work so hard in the fields. They are made to work so hard in the scorching heat of the sun. Then it shows that they irrigate the fields with their blood. The blood of your sight. See, they perspire, working under the heat of the sun. Their blood is converted into sweat. The sweat of your work, and this is your work, is the sweat of your work. He addresses the African people, slaves, the work of your slavery, You are worked by the colonialism as slaves. You work as slaves. The slavery of your children, even your children are also slaves. Africa, tell me, Africa. This is what we call apostrophe figure of speech. What we call, he is addressing Africa. Africa means African slaves. Africa here means African slaves. Is this you, this back that is bent? Your means the slave's back is bent due to heavy work. Is this you, this back that is bent? Just because of this slavery, your back is bent. This back that breaks under the weight of humiliation. See, you are humiliated. This back trembling with red scars. See, red scars are there on the back. They are hit by the hunters. They are made to work. And saying, yes, the whip under the midday sun. And when they are hit by the whips, they never say no. No negative answer is that they say yes. On every whip, the red scars are seen on their back. But a grave voice answers me, impetuous son. Acting, impetuous means acting or done quickly without thought or spontaneous, without thinking. They say they work that tree there, see that tree. Tree, it is a symbol of the same, that tree there, in splendid loneliness, having its wild and faded flowers. Among us, the white people, white means white people, you are working. That is Africa, you are Africa. And this Africa is not white people's Africa, but it is your Africa that grows again patiently and obstinately. Obstinately means strongly, with full strength, stubbornly. And its fruit gradually acquires, but the fruits are there. The slavery what you are undergoing, one day the fruits are there. The bitter taste of liberty. The bitter taste of liberty. I will give this also. The bitter taste of liberty. This is oxymoron figures of speech. Figure of speech. See here, bitter and taste. It is a bitter taste of liberty. Liberty doesn't have bitter taste. But these two controversial words are there, so it is oxymoron figure of speech. When two negative words come together in a line, it is called oxymoron figure of speech. Silent tolerant. How tolerant can be silent? But it is silent tolerant. I'll give you another example. The kind cruelty of Sergeant Snipe. The kind cruelty of sentence, are kind and cruel, both are coming here, two negative words, so it is oxymoron figure of speech. The bitter taste of liberty, here this line. Now, here, I will give you a personification. Your beautiful black blood that irrigates the field, the beautiful black blood that irrigates the field, personification. Your beautiful black blood. This is elevation. That tree there is a splendid loneliness amidst white and faded flowers. This is metaphor. Metaphor figure of speech. Now I have last year told you, every simile can be compressed to metaphor and every metaphor can be expanded to simile. I have given an example. Oxymoron, the bitter taste of liberty. I have given you the bitter taste of liberty. So, I think you might have understood this poem. Now, I will give you all the summary of this poem. Reminiscence means remembering past events. Reminiscence means remembering past events, whatever had happened behind, back, past. The poem is a reminiscence about Africa. It is a past event of Africa, whatever had happened on the black people. A land about which the poet David Diop heard from his grandmother's song. He had not been to Africa, but he had heard the story of Africa, the story of slave people, African people, from his grandmother's song. He paints a vivid picture of the history of African colonialism and the strength of African people. How they have sustained, how they have endured the trouble taken by the African people. He says that he has never known Africa. He tells it in the poem. He had never known Africa. But despite the distance, he cannot deny how much it is a part of him. But he says, the blood flows in my veins. The African blood flows in my veins. The beautiful black blood which flows in his veins, the beautiful black blood which flows there, also flows in the veins of the poet, which flows in his veins, describes his African descent and shows how much Africa is a part of him and his love for it and its people. How much he loves this African people. And that Africa is a part of his life. He shows his anger and accusation when he stresses that it is the blood and sweat of his people which is irrigating the fields for the benefit of other people. The beautiful black blood irrigates the work in the field. It is actually for the benefit of others, not for their own benefit, because they are slaves. By this he is pointing a finger at the colonists who exploited black people and used them as slaves. How these colonists used them as slaves. These colonists were in minority, but still then, though these African Negroes, African slaves were in majority, but they have used them as slaves to profit from their hard labor. These colonists have profited themselves by taking hard labor from these people. He urges the black people to stand up to the pain and the humiliation that they are suffering in their own land. See, the humiliation given by the colonists, the troubles and tortures and tumults given by the colonists, they have sustained us, African people, in their own land. He reminds them of the strength and pride they have in them and to say no to the whip of the colonists which makes them work under the hot midday sun and leaves scars on their backs. Even in the hot midday sun they have worked. They never said no. Though they had scars on their backs, they had the whips on their backs in the hot sun. Despite the suffering, he urges them to be strong and remain unbent and not to let this break them despite the weight of their suffering. Despite of the weight of their suffering, they should not bend. They should not bend. They must be strong. He further says that the wise voice of Africa chides him for thinking impetuous thoughts, and implies to us that a continent lies to in wait for something to happen. And this African continent waits for the good results in future. It urges the Africans to be patient. He tells the Africans, be patient and not hasty like children, as there is change on the horizon. Always there will be a change in the horizon. Wait till the change comes. The tree, young and strong, the tree which the slaves have planted, the trees which they have erected, it is strong, represents the young people of Africa who are patiently, but stubbornly, but obstinately waiting until they get the liberty they want. They had to wait till they have to wait till they get liberty. That is independent. At the moment, the tree is alone. At the present, the tree is only one, meaning the African struggle is a lonely battle. This African struggle was a lonely battle. They themselves had to fight. We'll achieve the freedom and liberty they want, no matter how bitter the taste is getting it. How bitter the taste may be, but they have to wait. It is among the white and red. This is the fight, the quarrel, the war, the battle is between white and the black. Flowers, faded flowers, by which he means the colonists who will fade in time. The colonists will fade away, while the youthful Africans grow in strength and wait for their moment of freedom. And the youth Africans have to wait for their freedom. So, I have given you all this. Explained the poem, complete poem, total poem along with the summary. Now you all have to do is, you read this poem twice or thrice, it is for your homework. Three times you read the poem, underline the difficult words, underline the figure of speech, figures of speech I have given here, four figures of speech I have given. That is one, alliteration, second, personification, oxymoron and beautiful black blood, alliteration, figure of speech, personification, oxymoron. These things I have given here, and metaphor. And also the metaphor is there. I have given that metaphor line here. That tree. That tree there, that tree there, in splendid loneliness, faded flowers. This is metaphor. Figure of speech. So now what we are going to do is, you read thrice, at least write once, one time you write the poem, and then underline all these figures of speech, whatever I am, you are saying on the board, and you answer this question. Seven questions are there, you answer them, you answer these questions. One question, question one time and answer two times you write. Question one time and answer two times. This is for your homework assignment. I think I have completed the poem. You might have understood the poem, explanation, everything. You see, you go through the summary, whatever I have just told you all now. And try to take down the summary and do the needful in the matter. Thank you. Thank you very much.